What do we actually know about sleep differences between men and women? And what I actually want to know about is chromosomally.
Yeah.
So when you tease out the hormones, how is it that a particular, whether it's a polymorphism or some other activity at the level of the genome, how is that actually manipulating, manifesting itself into sleep?
Mm-hmm.
Any idea what mechanisms could possibly be there if it's not endocrine?
So in terms of mechanism of action, we know that, again, there's differences in sleep pressure. And if you unpack the onion, sleep pressure is manifest from increasing levels of adenosine production, extracellular adenosine production within the brain, particularly the basal forebrain, which is a wake-promoting area. So if sleep pressure is accumulating quickly, which seems to be the case in biological males by way of the testes determining gene, then there's more rapid accumulation of extracellular adenosine. And the only way to pay off that increasing sleep pressure is through daytime sleep.
Yeah.
And so with females, right, it just essentially means the rate of accumulation of sleep pressure is lower, which means that the production of extracellular adenosine would be lower. Now, whether that's been studied, it hasn't, but like hypothetically, just knowing with all the, you know, myriad of studies around accumulating sleep pressure and extracellular adenosine, we predict that's the mechanism of action.
I mean, that's the closest we can come
right
at this point, right? Is it fair? Is it a trope? I certainly know that it feels like the guys that I know versus the girls that I know, guys fall asleep fast.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
Is that actually been demonstrated? Do we know that?
So that's been demonstrated, again, in these preclinical transgenic mouse models using the four core genotype. It's also been demonstrated in human studies. So in those studies that were done in the 80s by Terry Lee and Rachel Manbear, that's exactly what they found is sleep onset for men is much quicker. But then when you look at time to restorative sleep, so that entry into stage three non-REM and then REM sleep, it is the latency is quicker for females. So it might take them longer to fall asleep, but to get that restorative sleep, it's much quicker and then much more efficient across the night.
Do we have any teleological or evolutionary guess as to why that setup is there?
I mean, I think it all goes back to child rearing, right? Like who's responsible for children, right? Men are responsible for propagating children, but, you know, women, like, they are the caretakers. And I think these are these built-in neurochemical, neuroanatomical circuits that exist because of, you know, relationships between who actually takes care of the child.
How much of it is, if you know, psychology versus biology there, right? So the classic thing you'll hear is like, oh, women ruminate more. They think about stuff more. They're paying attention. Or is it simply any host of cascades haven't kicked off yet? The pressure isn't high enough. Do we have any idea what I'm sure it's both are contributing, but.
Well, I think that's the psychological aspect from my lens is a part of that biological blueprint, right? Is because females are going to have greater vigilance and across the day. Well, what neurochemically is vigilance? It's increased acetylcholine release and activation of acetylcholine areas of the brain, like the basal forebrain. That are going to lead to that. But again, I see the world from the lens of nature versus nurture. So I'm not a very good colleague in departments of psychology.
Well, you have a degree in psychology.
I have an undergraduate degree in psychology, but really it's
neuroscience.
It's all neuroscience. I was fortunate enough that, you know, I did go to a university that really thrived on its neuroscience curriculum. So,
well, nonetheless, I heard you're a psychologist, and what I just heard you say was psychology is just misunderstood physiology. I get it. I get it. That's what you said.
Yes,
Dr. Brager said it.
Yes.
Hold my stamp to that. Acetylcholine.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a total concentration issue that generally is higher, or is it a receptor density, or is it both? Do we have any idea what are actually the sex differences between acetylcholine?
That's a good question. I mean, The studies that I know exist on sex differences focus on one particular area, which is the basal forebrain, right? Mm. That is the seat of major acetylcholinergic production and release and activation within the brain. And then there's like cascading effects on other areas. But I actually think this is the land of great unknown. Yeah. I mean, there haven't been a lot of studies on sex differences and physiology and behavior. And if there were, they were done, again, in the 80s and 90s. Holy. And now, you know, got me curious about going back onto PubMed and Google Scholar and looking this up. But
yeah, I mean, the stuff that has been done since then, a lot of it is questionnaires. Yep. Right. It is. It's like pretty low fidelity stuff.
Yeah.
Which is good and helpful, but better.
I mean, you need self-report. I mean, with our sleep studies that we do in humans now, right, we always have an objective endpoint, endocrine or even a behavioral cognitive measure, but it's always paired with self-report. And sometimes the self-report data is what lends the more interesting findings.
So women... men fall asleep differently. We get that. What about total duration and waking up time? Any sex differences that are notable there?
So I'm happy you asked that because I feel like there have been, that data has been taken a little bit too far on social media that women need more sleep than men. There is a difference in total sleep time between men and women that was found again in these studies in the 1980s. And it's about 25 minutes to 30 minutes different. But I come from this lens, is that clinically significant? Mm-hmm. And that, I can't answer that, but I feel like in social media, that has been, people have taken that information and have run with it that, you know, women need to spend, I think I saw something recently, like, because women take this long to fall asleep, they need to be in bed for 9.5 hours. Versus a guy who, you know, falls asleep quickly, they only need to be in bed for 8. And I think at a certain point, like that's just going to create anxiety around the act of sleeping that it's going to be more harmful than helpful.
I assume then also based on this, men nap more than women do.
Yep. Yeah, yeah. No, we know that. Like we know that experimentally, we know that anecdotally. You know, you just look at cultures around the world that have siestas it's adopted and celebrated that like people nap during the day. As we know that men in general across cultures are more prone to daytime sleepiness.
Do you know if
and transgenic mice too?
Oh, yeah. You know? Name there. Are people napping more or less or the same than we have historically?
That I don't know. I mean, I feel like at least in the last 10 years, that stigma around napping has been reduced, I would say. I mean, it still exists in the military. I don't think it's going away. We actually, my colleagues and I from Walter Reed, we have a paper that we published in the flagship journal of sleep it's called The Stigma of Workplace Napping. And we strategically anonymously took quotes from senior leaders in the military. And I mean, we were flabbergasted. They were like, no, if my employees nap, they're lazy. Like they're not productive. And I'm like, you're okay. I'm just whatever. You know?
If you enjoyed this clip, you can watch the full episode by clicking here.